So far we've been talking about basic dominant recessive allele interactions. However, there are alternative ways for alleles to interact, and we refer to some of those alternatives as non-Mendelian genetics. So we can have codominant alleles, we can have incomplete dominance, we can have situations where there's more than just two alleles, we can have polygenic traits, and we can have sex-linked traits. And we're going to go through and briefly describe each one of these. So, like I said, so far we've been talking about dominance and recessive kind of relationships. And this is when an individual is heterozygous, the phenotype is based on the dominant allele, Mendelian genetics. An alternative to that is codominance, and that means if an individual is heterozygous, both alleles are expressed. So instead of just the dominant, in the phenotype, you're going to see both alleles expressed. In incomplete dominance, the heterozygous individuals will have an intermediate phenotype that is halfway between the dominant and the recessive phenotype. So let's give a simple example where big R means red and little r means white. If you are big R, big R, you are red. If you are little r, homozygous recessive, you're white. And that would be true for any of these situations. But if you are big R, little r, and you have a dominant recessive relationship, you would be red because the big R dominates and you end up with a red flower. Codominance, you would actually end up with a flower that is both red and white. Maybe it has stripes or spots, but you would see both of those alleles expressed equally. Finally, with incomplete dominance, the heterozygote is going to be pink. It's going to be a mix of the two colors and an intermediate. So one of the simple ways to recognize in a population if you've got a trait that has regular dominant recessive Mendelian genetics or some other kind of interaction, imagine looking at a population, maybe a field of 1,000 flowers. Do you only see two phenotypes? If there are only two phenotypes, that's a hint that you've got Mendelian genetics. If you see three, red, white, and red and white flowers, or red, pink, and white flowers, that starts to tell you that maybe we have some other kind of interaction happening. The next kind of non-Mendelian genetics I want to mention is the idea that there's more than two possible alleles. And blood type is a really nice example of this. There are three different possible alleles, and remember, your genotype only has two. With allele 1, your red blood cells produce antigen A. This is a protein sticking out of the cell membrane of the red blood cell. If you have allele 2, your red blood cells produce antigen B. And if you have allele 3, your red blood cells don't produce a specific antigen. Now, you could have two copies of allele 1, or you could have allele 1 and 2, or 2 and 3. You have all these different combinations. So here's an example of a cell that has two copies of allele 1. This is an example, two copies of allele 2. This individual has one copy of allele 1, one of 2, and this individual has two copies of allele 3. So here again, if we look at this graphic, we notice that there are six possible genotypes. So you could be AA, BB, II, the I refers to the type O blood, AB, AI, or BI. And these are all listed here. If we look at the possible phenotypes, we have type A, type B, type O, and type AB blood. One of the things I want you to notice here is that there are six possible genotypes, but only four possible phenotypes. So there are two different genotypes that both give rise to type A blood, and two different genotypes that give rise to type B blood. And again, when you start to see multiple phenotypes, then you start to think, wait a minute, maybe there are more than two alleles involved in this particular trait. So we can look back at a Punnett square and blood type and answer some interesting questions. Can a man with type O blood be the father of a child with type AB blood? So let's put the type O blood genotype in. We don't know what mother is, but if we look at all these combinations, you'll see that none of them could be AB. And this is the stuff of bad daytime TV, where they do blood tests to determine who could potentially be the father. Can children have different blood type than their parents? Go home and have an awkward conversation when you realize mom and dad have a different blood type than you, and start to have questions for what happened in your family. Well, let me show you this example. Here, the father has type A blood, mother has type B blood. Then we look at all the zygote combinations, AB, BI, AI, and II, and notice that the kids have an equal probability of having all the different blood types. And you could, in fact, have a father with type A, mother with type B, and a child with AB or type O. So as an aside, we sometimes hear about different blood types being the universal recipients, universal donors. Remember, our immune system reacts to proteins on the outside of cells. And so the universal recipient is someone who is type AB. You can put any of these other kinds of cells into their body and the immune system will assume it's normal. The universal donor is type O blood. This blood cell can be put into any kind of individual, but they can only receive blood from other type O individuals. So one of the things I want you to consider is what kind of allele interaction is happening. Earlier in this video, we talked about dominant recessive interactions and codominance and incomplete dominance. And if you look at these different things, what do you think the kind of interactions would be? Here, when we have A and B equally expressed, that would be an example of codominance. And then when these individuals can be AI, that is an example of dominant recessive. So within blood type, we have both the dominant recessive interaction and the codominant interaction. People often ask me at this point, what's the positive and negative? Where does that come into your blood type? Like I'm A positive or O negative. The positive or negative is a separate protein that extends from your red blood cells called the Rh factor. And if you have the Rh factor sticking out, you are positive. If you don't, you are negative. And again, this is related to how your immune system reacts. The ultimate donor, therefore, would be an O negative individual, and the ultimate recipient is going to be someone who's AB positive. The Rh factor is mostly a concern for women who are Rh negative, and they have the potential to have a baby who is Rh positive. For whatever reason, the Rh factor seems to really trigger the immune system, and women who are Rh negative run the risk of their immune system attacking the developing fetus. And so one of the reasons it's important to visit a doctor early in a pregnancy is to determine if this is an issue, and you can take some medications that reduce that influence through the pregnancy.